Good morning. My name is Phillip Agee, and I want to make this comment. Thank you. I'm slightly concerned that someone is going to walk out of here disappointed, depressed, thinking that these practices of anti-communism and McCarthyism have ended. I think I'm living proof that they have not. And I thought I might just contribute a couple of remarks on my current passport case, because in the last few days something very extraordinary has happened. With your permission, I will do this.
I wish you would. Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, in 1979, at the beginning of the Iranian hostage crisis, my passport was revoked. And as most of us here know, in the 40s and 50s, even going into the 60s, passports were denied to hundreds, if not thousands, of Americans on the basis of their political beliefs and associations. These were mainly communists and other left-wingers. Well, there were some landmark cases in the Supreme Court, Kent, Zemal, and others, which ended that more or less. But back in the 60s, the State Department put on its regulations a provision so that the Secretary of State could deny or revoke a passport if he certified that a person's activities were causing serious damage to the national security and foreign policy of the United States. That's the operative phrase, are causing or are likely to cause serious damage to the national security or foreign policy of the United States. This was invoked for the first time in my case in 79. Well, we went to the district court, of course, saying this was unconstitutional, that the Congress had not conferred the power on the president to revoke or hold back passports on those grounds. We won on the district court level. The case went to the Court of Appeals. We won again. Then the government appealed to the Supreme Court, and I knew when they took the case that we had lost. And I told my lawyer, look, let's not make a bad precedent. Let's just quit. Because in the meantime, my problem for traveling had been resolved. I'm also living proof that solidarity is a two-way street, because just a couple of few weeks after my passport was revoked, I received a letter from the revolutionary leader in Grenada, Morris Bishop, which was an invitation to the first anniversary of the revolution. And with the letter, he sent me a Grenadian passport. And that was my travel document. I went all over Western Europe, Canada, Caribbean, so forth, with my Grenadian passport until the invasion. At the time of the invasion of Grenada, I was in Nicaragua at a solidarity conference. And I spoke to the Sandinistas about the certainty that my passport would be revoked as soon as Reagan could put a caretaker government in power in Grenada. And the Sandinistas said, of course, Phil, you know we back your work. We appreciate what you've done with us. We're going to give you a Nicaraguan passport. Well, I live in Madrid, and I've been coming back to the States now since last year, first time in 16 years. And when I arrive at Kennedy Airport each time, I put my Nicaraguan passport up on that counter. But to make the story short, the case went to the Supreme Court. They overturned the first two decisions, and they overturned their own decisions, Kent, Zemal, and the others, because they said Wade McCree argued the case for the government. He was the Solicitor General then. He said that Mr. Agee's actions have gone far beyond simple words, because we were arguing it on speech, you know, First Amendment. He says they are deadlier, his words, are deadlier than bullets. Why, just last week, two Americans were killed down in El Salvador. They were down there under cover of some kind of labor organization, and for the first time officially, the American Institute for Free Labor Development was confirmed as providing cover and working with the CIA. This was Hammer and Pearlman. You remember in 1981 they were killed at the Sheraton Hotel in El Salvador. Well, that was the end of it. I didn't have the passport. Well, last year, as a first step toward coming back to the United States, I hadn't made up my mind yet, I did apply for a U.S. passport. That was in January of last year. In June, to my great satisfaction, I didn't get the passport, but Schultz did certify that my activities are continuing to cause serious damage to the national security and foreign policy of the United States. So we had to go into the appeal process. And first you have an administrative appeal within the Department of State according to regulations, then to the courts again. So last October, we have the hearing before a hearing officer in the Department of State. The regulations say the affected person has the right to see all the evidence against him on which the Secretary's decision was based, plus the right to confront and cross-examine every adverse witness. Well, at the hearing, we find that Schultz made his decision in certification solely on the basis of a 12-point memorandum, 12 allegations by William Webster, the DCI, the Director of Central Intelligence, against me. We demanded over and over again during the hearing that they produce Webster because the regulation says I have the right to confront and cross-examine every adverse witness, and he was the only witness. They refused. So the case goes on up the ladder and goes to the Court of Appeals.
Okay, give him another minute,
this
please.
Is the end of it.
Yeah.
It goes to the Board of Appellate Review. They have it for months and months, and just this past week, I get the decision from the Board of Appellate Review. They have sent the case back to the Department of State for another hearing, saying that they didn't follow their own regulations, and they have to produce Webster for me. What do you think about that? I can't wait to ask him, sir, would you please state your name and occupation? Are you or have you ever been a member of the American Nazi Party?